Today, I want to look at how to animate with easing functions in p5.js. And let's start with the very basics. And here up on my screen, I have a very simple p5 sketch with a single circle. And here's what I want to do. I want to animate the circle from left side to the right side. So the first thing I need to do is to define these two coordinates, these two positions. And I will define two variables. First one is called from, and the second one is called to. So we'll be animating from to to. And in the setup function, I will initialize the values. So from will be, let's just pick some random number. X is 200 and Y is 500. And 2 will be on the other side. So how about 800 and 600? And to move from position to to position, we can use lerp function. Lerp function, or in other words, linear interpolation function, takes three parameters. So first one is a start value, and the second is stop value, and the third one is amount. Amount goes from 0 to 1. So when you put amount 0, it will return start value, and amount of 1 will return stop value, and any value in between will be the value between start and stop. So if you give amount of 0.5, this function will return the middle value between start and stop. So we'll use the lerp function twice for each dimension, x and y. So from at index of 0 to 2 index of 0 by some amount. Let's just say for now 0.0. And this will return a value that I will store in x. And I will do the same with y. I'll just copy the line and change to y and the index from 0 to 1. And I will use the same amount because we are animating both x and y at the same time. And now, instead of drawing our ellipse at the center, we'll use x and y. Then as you can see, our circle is now placed at from position 200, 500 because we use amount of 0. If we change the amount to 1, and you can guess where that will go, to 800, 600. And now to animate in between these from and to positions, we need to update our amount from 0, starting at 0, and then gradually updating. So you can go all the way up to 1.0. And can you think of any variable that sort of increments over time? In P5, we have frame count, which increments by 1 each frame. So how about we use that? So I'm going to just store this to a variable called t, and I will replace these hard-coded numbers to t. Then something happened, but the circle disappeared. That's because frame count increments by 1, but what we need in the lerp amount should be between 0 and 1. So this value is too big. So what I can do is just manually multiply with some very small value, so it will increment very little each frame. So now we can see it is going from 200 by 500 to 800 by 600. Very slowly. So if you change this value, we can control sort of the duration of our animation. But this is not enough because it is now going over the amount of 1 eventually because frame count will continue to increase. So we'll need to set a condition so the ellipse will stop moving when it reaches the destination. So I will need to introduce another variable called duration or total duration. This will be the duration of this animation. How long do you want this to play? For now, we're using frames. We have to think in terms of frames. Let's just say 60 frames in frames. Then I will introduce if statement. If frame count is less than total duration, then I will continue to update x and y value. Otherwise, whatever the last values were, we'll be using it to draw ellipse. But there's a problem here because x and y is defined within if statement, so ellipse cannot see it. So I'm gonna have to change the structure a little bit. So let's define x and y up here. Then now the circle goes for 60 frames and stops at the end. But here's a problem. When you rely on frame count for time-sensitive animation, the actual duration of the animation is dependent on frame rate. Let me show you. If I set frame rate to 60, which is I think most displays are based on, then when we set total duration of 60, our animation will play for about 1 second. So that's fine, but what if someone has pretty old computer device and it only supports up to 30 frames per second? When you do that, now the animation is twice as slow, because at 30 frames per second, total duration of 60 frames will be 2 seconds long. What about frame rate of 10? That's like 6 times slower. So when you rely on frame count for your animation, you can't really predict how it's going to play on your user's devices. So let's move on and improve this sketch a bit more by introducing time to control our animation. And I'm going to introduce one more variable called time passed. How much time has passed since the beginning of the animation? So at the beginning, it'll be initialized to just 0. And now, total duration will set in terms of seconds. And 60 seconds is too long, so let me change to, say, 1.5 seconds. And we also need to change our if statement, so it will not rely on frame count, and instead use time. Then how do we use time here? Well, p5 doesn't have time count, but it has delta time variable. It's a system variable, so we can just use it. Delta time. And you can see the description here. The system variable delta time contains the time difference between the beginning of the previous frame and the beginning of the current frame in milliseconds. This variable is useful for creating time-sensitive animation or physics calculation that should stay constant regardless of frame rate. So that's exactly what we want in this case. A few things to note here is that delta time will be a different value between each frame. Even if you set a frame rate to something like 60, the delta time will not always be consistent. And the other thing is that the unit of measurement here is milliseconds instead of seconds, because we set total duration in seconds, but there's a difference here. Now back to our code. So each frame, I'm going to add delta time to time passed. So the value will accumulate, but here's one more thing to do, because delta time is in milliseconds, so we're going to have to multiply by 0.001 to make it in the unit of seconds. And we also have to change frame count to time passed. We'll also have to change it a bit, so time passed divided by total duration. So this will always give us the result that's between 0 and 1. Now when you play the animation, it moves a circle for the total duration of 1.5 seconds. And we can change that. How about 2.5 seconds now? So that's a bit slower. How about 0.3 seconds? That's a lot faster. Let's put it back to 1.5. And I'm going to show you the difference between using frame count and this time delta time, by setting frame rate to something very low. As you can see, the animation is pretty choppy because there are only 10 frames each second, but in terms of total duration, it is still 1.5 seconds. Same when I increase the frame rate to 60. Animation is a lot smoother, but also it plays for the same 1.5 seconds. Now let me add a little bit of mouse interaction. I'm going to define mouse press function. So each time when I press my mouse, the circle will move towards my mouse clicked position. We're going to have to update two value to the current mouse X and mouse Y position. We'll also have to reset time passed back to 0 so the animation can start again. If you save it and test it, yes, circle moves to my mouse clicked position, But it's a little bit wrong here, right? Because two position looks like it's working fine, but the front position will also have to update. So back to our code in the mouse pressed function, I'm going to also update from to current X and Y position. Now testing again. Yes, it's working fine. And you can even interrupt in the middle and it'll change the course, because we are always referring to the current X and Y position to be the from position. So this is looking great, but a bit boring because the movement itself is very linear, right? It's a constant speed, constant motion. So it's time to introduce easing functions. And here I am on the website called easings.net. There are lots and lots of easing functions with a very different characteristics of motion. You see this tiny little mark here? If you see how it's moving, sometimes it's starting slow, getting faster, and ending slower. Or sometimes it starts slow and goes really fast at the end. So there are all kinds of different motions you can choose from. And for now, I like to use this one, ease in out quint. If I click it, and if you go all the way down, then you can just copy this function and use it in our sketch. I'm going to just copy it back to our sketch and paste it. And then it gives you an error. That's because the function we just copied and pasted is in TypeScript. You see, there's a colon number and here another colon and number. That's part of TypeScript, not vanilla JavaScript. We're going to have to delete it. And now it's back to normal. And just like the lerp function takes the amount between 0 and 1, this easing function also takes a parameter that's between 0 and 1. So that's great because our t value here is already normalized to 0 to 1. So all we need to do is surround it with this easing function. Is in our quint and then pass t value. Same with y. And now when I interact with my mouse click, you can see it looks a lot more interesting. There are many different types of easing equations on this website, easings.net. So I suggest that you try a couple at least. And I just want to try one more. This time I want to try something quite different. How about I use ease in expo? It starts slow and then gets really fast at the end. So let me take the function here. Just copy it. Come back to our code and paste it. Just like the last time, we need to delete the TypeScript bit here. And then replace our easeInoutQuint function with easeInExpo. Now when you try it, it has a very different type of motion. But there is a subtle problem here. Do you see how the circle sort of stops before it can reach my mouse position? Check this out again. Just like that. It's kind of missing maybe like 20, 30 pixels here. When it's like moving a large distance and gets really fast at the end, it misses the target. That's because of our condition. Our if statement only runs as long as time passed is less than total duration. But sometimes animation cannot be finished before total duration, especially when the travel distance is pretty large each step. There is some leftover distance to travel at the end. But here's a quick fix. I'm going to add else, meaning at the end of the animation, we'll just set the X and Y value to 2 position. So it'll sort of snap to the end value. And I'm going to try it again. This time, no matter how much leftover space is there, it will always snap at the end of each animation. So that's the basics of working with easing functions in p5.js or more in general in JavaScript. This will become a building block of more complex animation you'll be doing. And I'll see you in the next video.